Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
It's Dan and Matt back with you for another week of Talking Flames Hockey, and this is a week when the Flames went just over 500. Not something that we've seen a lot from this team at all this season. So why don't we jump right in, Matt, and discuss the games of the week?
Sounds like a plan. Let's go.
We started off this week by playing the Winnipeg Jets, another team who really has not been doing all that well. They're currently bottom of the Western Conference, and the Flames ended up winning this one 4-1. It was I thought it was a game you'd expect from two bottom teams. It wasn't a great game to watch. I mean, it's always fun when the Flames win, but it wasn't a great game to watch. It was kind of what I was expecting here. There was some offense, not a lot of offense. What was your thoughts?
Pretty much what you're saying. I think that pretty much goes for most of the games this week. Players are trying to earn spots for next year on both sides. And that's basically the only thing that was really noteworthy about most of the games this week.
You know, it's interesting in this game, we saw the first goal of the game from Joe Colborne. And, you know, it's interesting, him kind of coming alive again. And he had a pretty good week all week, I think. And Colborne's a guy who a lot of people have talked about maybe trading, maybe getting rid of in the offseason. He's a guy who can be really streaky, but when you see a week like he's had this week, I almost think that he's worth bringing back in that, you know, bottom six role.
Yeah, typically bigger guys like Colborne, it takes a while for them to really establish themselves properly at the NHL level. And we've seen flashes of good play from him in each of the last three seasons. But this year, and especially since the trade deadline, he seems to be really coming into his own and having a prolonged hot streak, which is something that he hasn't really had. Like, he'll get hot for a couple of games and then he'll disappear again. But more recently, he's seeming to be taking the steps forward to that next level in his development. Whether that lingers the rest of the season and into next year is still to be determined, but I have no problem with him returning as a third, fourth line guy.
Another guy that looked really good in this game, who I think is coming into his own as well, is Michael Ferland. Ferland looked good. He's coming into his own. And also, I think Michael Frolik, both Michaels on the team. Ferland's getting back to the way we saw him play last year against Vancouver. He's getting that tough edge back on him. We saw him get the fighting major against JC Lippin. And I don't know, he was noticeable the whole game to me. And I think they've taken him out of trying to be an offensive player. And he's really just that agitator. And Frolik, as much as I think he's playing over his head a bit right now, I'm glad to see that after all his injuries, he's coming out and showing us that, you know what, he can be a good offensive force for the Flames.
Well, Frolik has always been that consistent 35 to 45 point player in his career. And if you're expecting him to be like a first line player for you, you're likely going to be disappointed, but he's always a solid, steady contributor.
He's not the next Yari Hoodler.
No, he's just a very good second, third line player. He won a cup with Chicago. Just, you need good middle six players, and Frolik is that. I find it interesting that since Garnett Hathaway has joined the club, that Michael Ferland has become a lot more physical in each contest. I think that Hathaway's presence may be pushing Ferland to fight for his job for next season.
Yeah, that could be. I think you're probably definitely right about that, is that Ferland has to fight again. And I think Boma didn't give him that fight like he was last year. I think last year we were seeing Boma fighting for that. And I could easily see the Flames replacing, if they had to, Ferland with Hathaway to keep that same edge on the team.
Mm-hmm. And that's one of the good things about having that internal competition, is whoever wins will be the better player. It's just you can't say that, oh, for sure it's going to be Ferland, for sure it's going to be Hathaway. It could be Josh Juris. You don't know. Because Juris has been throwing the body around quite a bit in recent games as well, including the Toronto game.
Yeah, I'm not sure that I think that Juris is going to end up with that kind of role on the team. But, I mean, we saw even last year, he can throw that body when he wants to or needs to, but I don't think that he's sort of your agitator going forward. I think he's more of your sort of two-way third line or even fourth line guy who works with those guys as a puck mover.
Yeah.
Another interesting addition to the lineup for this game was Freddie Hamilton. We saw both Hamilton brothers reunited, Dougie and Freddie, and I think this is the first time since juniors that they've played together. And Hartley actually put them on the opening starting lineup together. What did you think of Freddie's performance?
Pretty much the same that I've seen him playing in Stockton all year. Just solid, steady, does what he needs to do. He's never going to be a top 9 player. He's pretty much, like, if he sticks in the NHL, he'll be a fourth line center. But he did a solid job. Nothing to complain about. He killed penalties. He scored a shorthanded goal in the Colorado game. Just solid. He won, I think it was 60-some-odd percent of his face-offs. So
yeah, in the Winnipeg game, he had 2 shots, 2 hits, 2 blocks, 1 giveaway, and 1 takeaway. Won 62% of his face-offs, played 33 seconds on the shorthand, and 12 minutes and 4 seconds total time on ice, which is quite a bit for a call-up.
Mm-hmm. And it's interesting with his level of play in that game. I wonder if the Flames may try to find a suitor somewhere in the offseason for Matt Stajan, because Freddie Hamilton pretty much brings the same skill level, at least, to the game. Not necessarily the veteran experience, but
I think Stajan's a tough contract to move right now.
So do I. But there are some teams that could use some veteran leadership, like a team like, say, Toronto, that could use a solid veteran guy. You'd probably have to eat some of the contract, but
Stajan has a no-trade clause, too, and I don't know. It seems like he likes it here. I don't know where he would go.
Well, he is from Toronto and used to play for them, so
yeah, I can't see the Leafs taking him back, though.
True. So it's a possibility.
And we'll talk about it later in the show, but I think he's a good candidate to be taken if there is an expansion draft in a couple of years.
That could be.
Freddie Hamilton looked to me like a call-up guy. You know, he made some mistakes. He wasn't great. I agree with you that he could be that fourth-line center. I don't know that they'll get rid of Stajan. I think that Freddie's got a role here if he wants it. But I could also see them try to transition him to be a winger. I don't know that he just didn't seem as sharp as you want your centers to be sometimes, and maybe it's just because he was just called up. But I don't know. He seemed to me like he could fit well maybe on a right or left wing.
Mm-hmm.
The other interesting note in this game is Dennis Wiedemann played just over 4 minutes before going out with an injury, and this is an injury that's expected to keep Wiedemann out for the remainder of the season. So we've lost
a fun end of the year for poor Dennis Wiedemann. First, he gets that suspension for 19 games, comes back for a couple, and then right back out for the final 13.
Yeah, he's I don't know. I have a feeling just myself that maybe he doesn't need to sit out all year, but they're just kind of shutting him down because they want to try some other blue liners anyways. But, yeah, it's unfortunate timing for him, and I think this could also start to foretell his future with the Flames as well. If they're going, geez, we can get along just fine without this guy, maybe it says, you know, we should try to move him a little bit harder than we have been.
Mm-hmm. And especially with him being an expiring contract next year, even if the Flames were forced to eat a million or two of his contract, you could get away with having, say, Joki Paka taking his spot without there being much of any difference. Like, Joki Paka has 5 assists in his games with the Flames thus far, so not doing too badly at generating offense.
Weidman's one of these guys who I could see moving as a rental early in the year next year. I don't think that they'll necessarily wait till the deadline to try and deal him. I could see him moving even before the season starts if the Flames can absorb some money.
Mm-hmm.
Well, after that game against Winnipeg, the Flames took on the Colorado Avalanche, led by our former captain, Jerome McGinley, who came to town. And this one was, I thought this was of the week's games, this might have been one of the funnest hockey games to watch as far as the back and forth goes. Because every time one team got momentum, the other one seemed to start playing better. We saw who you were talking about earlier, Matt Stajan, get his fifth of the year. And I was really shocked at the time that this was Stajan's fifth, because you'd expect him to have better production than that. And then we got shorthanded goals from Mark Giordano and Freddie Hamilton, his first as a Flame. And those were the three for Calgary, and Colorado ended up winning this. It was 3-3 going into the third, nothing in overtime, and they ended up winning in the shootout. So, Matt, overall thoughts on this game?
The Flames, they played okay. Not bad, not great. I thought that Colorado was probably the better team throughout the night, and if it wasn't for the two shorthanded goals in quick succession, I think the Avalanche would have won that one in regulation.
Yeah.
Overall, they're playing, the Flames have been playing at a decent clip. It's just they're a bottom of the standings team, and even when they're playing at their best, a playoff caliber team like the Avalanche should beat them. And they did.
Yeah, they did. I mean, it shouldn't take a shootout to beat the Flames. I think tells you something either about the way the Avalanche were playing or the way the Flames were playing. I'd say the Avalanche were probably playing down to their opponents in that one. But I think that the Flames were getting some hot flashes in this game, and then the Avalanche would sort of shut them down. You know, you kind of saw after the two goals in the second, the Flames started to rally back, and the Avalanche were able to contain them. And I think that says something about the Avalanche being able to really dictate the pace of a game, which we generally don't see a lot of from them. I always find they're kind of playing their opponent's game.
Yeah, more reactive than dictating.
Yeah, very similar to what we've often seen in the past with the Flames, where you have a roster that can play a whole lot of different games, and you just kind of decide what game to play based on what your opponent's playing. So I thought it was good that we saw them taking the advantage here and dictating how the Flames were going to play, which I think threw the Flames off. Jerome McGinley obviously got a goal in this one, which is good. I always like to see Jerome doing well, even if it's against the Flames. And another former Flame that I thought had a good game against us was Blake Como, a guy who was really never got his fair shake, I don't think, here in Calgary. But, yeah, he was doing well. And interesting, too, I thought, in the overtime, Joni Ordio got a penalty for tripping Jerome McGinley. So I thought that was kind of funny.
Yeah. Actually, McGinley did not score. He got an assist.
Right. My bad. Yeah, he got on the score sheet, I meant to say.
Yeah.
But, yeah, he got the assist on the Tyson Berry goal.
Yeah.
And that's
actually, one thing that shocked me is Blake Como only has 10 fewer points than McGinley this season.
Really?
Yeah, he's doing that well.
Or McGinley's not doing as well.
Well, McGinley's got, I think, 43 points to Como's 33.
Okay, so maybe Blake's finally found a club where he can really become the player he should be.
Yeah, well, he was very good in his first couple seasons with the Islanders, and then he just fell on off the face of the earth for a few years. So it seems that he's found his game again, which good for him. You know, you don't like to see players that have skill just disappear.
No, and it's taken him a couple years to rebound, but maybe this is the right system. Maybe the Patrick Waugh system is right for him. And then after that game, the Flames went on a bit of an Eastern Conference road trip. And they went to Eastern Canada, playing the two big Eastern Canada Original Six teams, the first one being the Montreal Canadiens. And this is one where the Flames, I think, no matter what metric you look at, dominated this game, winning 4-1 against the Canadiens. And as a note here, the Flames saw for the first time in net and the first time he's played an NHL game in, I believe, over 18 months.
14.
How many months?
14
months? Okay. So still over a year. Number 32, Nick Backstrom picked up the win here. Matt, overall thoughts on this game?
The first 36 minutes of this game was painful to watch. There was only one scoring chance that was of any note, and that was the 2-on-1 with about 8 minutes left to go in the second period by Montreal. And then after a couple of excellent passing plays from Brody to Colborne and Hamilton to Monahan gave us the lead, and then the Flames just kept going from there.
Yeah, it was a weird game to watch for the Flames. I mean, Montreal's fallen apart. I kind of knew the Flames would probably do well against them. I didn't expect this sort of a lopsided game, though. Not only did the Flames outscore them, I thought the Flames just outplayed Montreal all night.
Yeah, and you can see that reflected in the shot total. It was 35-22.
Well, and looking at pretty much any stat, the only thing that Montreal really won on was faceoff wins. Power play, Calgary went 1-for-3 to Montreal's 0-for-1. Calgary had 46 hits to Montreal's 33. They're really liberal with their hit counts in Montreal.
Yeah.
Wow. 36 wins to 24 is Montreal's faceoff wins. We had 18 giveaways, not really the stat you want to lead in, to Montreal's 9, and 7 takeaways to their 3. So, you know, we're still a bottom team, and we still look like it here, but good to see that, you know, the Flames were able to dominate Montreal.
And if there was any doubt that Carey Price is the best player in the NHL, that's been verified this season. In his 12 games played, he was 10-2. And since then, Montreal has been 24-32-6.
Ouch.
Which, that would actually be a worse record than the Toronto Maple Leafs, who was the worst team in the league. So,
yikes.
Yeah. He's basically, the last handful of years is the only reason why they haven't been synonymous as the Edmonton Oilers of the Eastern Conference.
Yeah, when I watched Mike Condon play in this game, I just thought, you know what, this guy should not, like, there's got to be better options in their system than this guy. He didn't seem all that confident most of the night.
No, he's all right. He's a decent backup caliber guy. It's just, unfortunately, Montreal's relying on him to be the starter all year, and not much he can do.
So Matt Wotherspoon got called up again. After Derek England was not in the game, the Flames thought they might have to play with only 5 defensemen and 13 forwards. Wotherspoon's, I hope he's got a good-to-go bag, because this guy's going up and down. He's going to get more frequent flyer miles than, I think, any Flame this season. Congratulations to the Englands on their new daughter, Talon. Wotherspoon, you know, another game for the Flames, another big minute game. He played 14:37. What's your assessment of Wotherspoon now that we've seen him playing around this team for a couple weeks?
He's a solid 6'7 defenseman. I don't think he's going to develop into anything much more than just a decent fill-in guy for his career. I don't see him emerging as a top 5 defenseman at all. Yeah, he's had a busy week, though. On Saturday, he played in Stockton against Bakersfield. Then got, it was a late game. Went to the airport at, like, 1 in the morning. Got the flight to Montreal. And arrived at 5:10 in the building. Local time. So, like, just after the national anthems. And had to quickly get dressed so he could get out there. So, and then he played...
And he played back-to-back.
Yeah, so 3 games in 3 days.
So you hope that he's the guy who gets some time off after this. There's an optional practice in his future, I think. Matt, what'd you think of Backstrom?
I thought he looked rusty at times. Like, you could tell, like, sometimes when the Canadians would fire the puck at him, he'd... like, there was one play where the puck just went right in and out of his glove. Other than that, though, like, you could tell that he's a starting goaltender and has been for his career. He was very composed in the net, even though he was a little, his timing was a little off. He should have got the shutout, but unfortunately that McCarron tip was perfectly placed. Other than that, he was solid. I have no complaints. If he was not 38, I would say that he would stand a good chance to be re-signed by the Flames, but have to evaluate the goalie market.
Yeah, I agree with your assessment here. You could tell this is a guy who understands the NHL game as a starting goaltender. He knew how to read the plays. He knew where he should be. He wasn't making some of the dumb mistakes that rookies make. But he was rusty, and it showed in his game that he hasn't played at this level in over a year, 14 months. So I think what I saw from him, I got a better performance than I was expecting from his first performance, but it still leaves a lot to be desired if he's going to try and become a starter in this league. He just needs to play somewhere.
Yeah, and I think that because he will be getting the start in Minnesota on Thursday, that the Flames may end up trying him another game or two in the final stretch just to see if he is showing more, because the Flames could always invite him to training camp to compete for the backup spot.
Yeah,
in case Ordeo plays badly again next year at the start of the year or whatever, he might be a good insurance option.
I could also see them signing him to a deal under $1 million and even reassign him to the AHL to back up Gillies down there.
Yeah, basically being the Joey McDonald type.
Yeah, but a better
guy.
Version of Joey McDonald. I mean, Joey was never really a starter of any
no.
note.
True.
But yeah, I can see them saying, okay, you're 38. We're going to sign you to a one-year deal. You go down to the A and prove you can make it back up here.
Yeah. We'll invite you to training camp. If you steal a spot, that's good. If not, then you get to be the veteran guy to help teach our prospect.
And based on what we've seen from him, he seems like he's really willing to do pretty much anything. You know, he seems like he's willing to be that teacher. He's willing to be that public face. And I think that Stockton could use that too, sort of the old, you know, public PR guy who everyone knows and who knows how to handle that. So I think there could be a lot of good for him going down and maybe getting his last year with Stockton. The last game of the week, let's move over to that and then we can move on to other topics. The last game of the week, the Flames played the second of a back-to-back in Eastern Canada, taking on the Toronto Maple Leafs. And there's a team who's really been decimated by injuries lately. They're not a great team, but they ended up winning 5-2 against the Flames. In this game, I thought the Flames played a terrible first period. That was awful hockey for 20 minutes. The second period, they started to sort of come back a little bit, and then, in my opinion, they just deflated in the third once again, as we see the Flames do all the time. Even though they were really only, you know, they were tied 2-2 after the second, as soon as the Nylander goal happened, I just thought that the Flames came apart again, as we see so often. What were your thoughts here, Matt?
Can't argue with you at all. And I thought it was nice that the Flames allowed Hiller the option to get another start instead of just being relegated to the sidelines for the remainder of the year. Each of these guys is trying to earn a spot somewhere next year, whether it's in the NHL or the AHL. And it anytime that a team does favors for players, that does nothing but boost their appreciation by players, because we're treating you with respect as a player.
Well, and other players around the league too see that.
Yeah, and anytime that you can do things like that to at least give the guy a shot to show that, hey, I still have it, even though the rest of my season's been bad. But unfortunately for Hiller, if either Backstrom or Ordeo started that game, I think the Flames win this one 2-0.
I agree. I think that a lot of the reason that the Flames lost was squarely on the man wearing number one between the pipes.
Yeah, the first goal for sure was his fault. The second one, I thought he was too far in the net. And the third one, He just didn't try to look around the screen at all, and it didn't hit him. So
the William Nylander goal, I thought, was a good goal.
I look at that goal that Jack Eichel scored in the Buffalo game earlier this month on him, and Hiller, he just drops to his knees, and he doesn't try to look around the screens at all. And if you just aim high towards one of the corners, you'll score on him. And I think Nylander knew that and tried it, and it worked. So I think another goaltender might have had that by throwing the glove out or not dropping to his knees.
It's got to be a bit humiliating for Hiller when a guy who hasn't played in over a year comes in and plays a better game, and then you come in and you kind of stink up the net. I think he may have lost his backup spot to Nicholas Backstrom.
I would expect that, actually, the rest of the way.
I'm expecting Hiller to be eating the popcorn up in the press box from here on out.
Same here. I think that Backstrom may get one of the starts in the back-to-back next week. Obviously, I actually wouldn't be surprised if he got the Anaheim game just to see if, hey, you're new, you haven't been dealing with this curse, why don't you try to stop it?
There you go. If you can stop the curse, we'll sign you. That's your carrot and stick there. You get us a win, you get a contract.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. To me, hand over fist, Nicholas Backstrom was better than Jonas Hiller, and better than, I think, in one game than Jonas Hiller's looked in any performance this year. I can't think of a good Jonas Hiller performance this year. I really think that this was Hiller's last game in a Flames jersey. I don't even think he'll be sitting on the bench as the backup from here on out. I think our new pairing is two guys who we never would have thought would be our pairing. Yoni Ordeo is the starter who got sent down to the AHL early in the year, and Nicholas Backstrom, who, you know, if you would have told me that he was going to be here, I wouldn't have believed you. So interesting to see how that goalie tandem has changed, and I really think that Hiller's probably done in North America after this as well.
I can't argue with you on any of that.
I think even if I was a coach looking to sign a veteran goalie, I'd probably look at Backstrom over Hiller at this point.
I would just rather go with the prospect internally than Hiller at this point.
And there's some rumors that Hiller's received some offers from Switzerland. He said he doesn't want to go there, but he's received some offers from Switzerland. And I can see that being his only option come the offseason.
Always you look to see what's available, and if you're not receiving any phone calls, then you go to Plan B.
Yeah, and I mean, at his age, Plan B could be retirement, too. It depends how much he wants to play.
True.
He's just getting off a big Calgary deal. He might just decide to take his money and ride off into the sunset. So, Matt, we have a week where the Flames are just above 500 hockey. I've never been a fan of let's tank, let's lose, let's, you know, do all these things to get a better draft pick. To me, you want to have an honorable team all the way out. You want to play hard right till the end of the year. But I know there's a lot of people who disagree with me. I know there's a lot of people who just want to get the loss from here on out to get a better draft pick. You did some math for us. Why don't you run through the stats that you found out?
Yeah, it's interesting with how the draft odds are set up for this year. Each of the top three picks are individually drafted through the lottery. So if you're picking fourth or finish with the fourth worst record, you'll have about a 9% chance of winning the lottery, and then depending on who actually does win the pick, the odds change. But with each successive chance, you have about a 9% chance. If you're finishing sixth, you have a 6% chance in each case. So even though the Flames have won at a lot recently, the difference between finishing fourth and finishing sixth, it's only 3%. So it's not that huge of a deal. And it's unlikely if the Flames finish with the sixth worst record that they'll fall further back. And with the players that are in the draft, if the Flames are picking, say, sixth, they'll have a choice between one of three really good defensemen and one of three really good forwards. So even though you're not getting one of the big Finns or Matthews, there are still good players available at 6 and 7. So that whole thing, it's a little bit overblown. And the Flames still have a 20% chance, give or take, to pick in the top three, even if they finish with the sixth worst record. So,
and I mean, if you look at the standings, we're not going up too much further. We're fourth in the West right now at 68 points. Arizona's 69 above us, and then 79 is Minnesota above them. So, I mean, there's no way we're going past, you know, fifth in the West.
No, and only realistically, the only two teams that we could catch are Buffalo and Arizona, who have 70 and 69 points. Everybody else, the Flames would have to make up 6 points in 9 games, which, give me a break, unless the Flames win out, that's not going to happen.
So, you know, to me, yeah, looking at the draft, I think there's, as we usually see, there's the one big name at number one. Everybody wants that guy. Only one team gets them. But I think there's enough supporting cast here in the top 8 or 9 where any of those players are going to be good for this team going forward. And arguably, we don't need the centerman. Arguably, we would be better to take one of the wingers or one of the D-men anyways.
Yeah. Like, if you look at, like, subtract the two Finns and Matthews from the equation, you've got Pierre-Luc Dubois, who's a 6'3" center. You've got Chychrun, who's been compared to Aaron Ekblad. Not quite as good, but close. Then you've got Matthew Tkachuk, who's very good. Mikhail Sergachev, Oli Juolevi. So, like, there are lots of really good players. Nylander's brother, he's in there, and he's equally talented as Nylander. So there are options. Like, if the Flames are picking 6th or 7th, they're going to be walking away with a top 6 forward or a top 4 defenseman.
Yeah.
So this draft is deep enough in the top end where even if the Flames were picking 8th or 9th, we would still be getting a good player.
Talking about the draft, Matt, and I agree with you on all that. I think that we are where we need to be, and I don't think we need a fall to get a good player. We're going to get a good player regardless. But there's been a lot of talk in the NHL about moving the drafting age up. I've heard some people say 20. I've heard some people say 19. What are your thoughts about the Flames tinkering with the draft?
Well, it wouldn't be the Flames tinkering with the draft.
What do you think? Let me try that again. Matt, there's been some talk lately in the NHL about the NHL changing the age in the draft. We're seeing a lot of, you know, 17, 18-year-old guys drafted now, especially in later rounds. The NHL's talking about moving the draft up to 19 or 20 are some of the rumors that we're hearing. What are your thoughts if they were to tinker with that?
I think that would be a good idea. When you're dealing with somebody that's 18, in the first round, you know that likely this guy's going to be good. But there are so many guys that either fall flat on their face or come out of nowhere when they're 19. And that would help to make things more successful for draft picks. Like, especially if they moved it up to 20, like, you could pretty much know that, okay, this guy is going to be, like, a first-line player. This guy is going to be a second-line player. And, like, we can just plug this guy in pretty much right away instead of having to wait for a long time. And it would remove a lot of the guesswork, at least in the top 40 or so picks. I think it wouldn't matter beyond that. I think in the third and fourth and fifth and beyond rounds, you're still going to have that randomness, but I think that it would help to clarify and make the first and second round draft picks even more valuable than they are now, and you would know exactly what you're getting pretty much,
to me,
with the exception of goaltenders.
to me, the issue we would have with that is we need to then come up with a whole new structure for hockey, I think. When you're drafting a kid who's 17, 18, even 19 out of the Canadian Hockey League primarily, we have this league for teenagers. And if we're waiting for them to become 20, I don't think that it's right to be – well, there's not enough room first off, but I don't think it's right for these guys to be playing in the WHL and being evaluated at 20 playing against 16-year-olds. So I think if they're going to do this, even if they want to move it up to 19, we almost need to create a new league after – the 18-year-olds, after that 18-year-old league in the, or that 18-year-old year in the CHL, we need to have somewhere for these guys to go. I don't think Europe is necessarily the right answer, but I almost think there needs to be another league. We've seen so many leagues shut down recently, this United Hockey League, the Central Hockey League, even the IHL back in the early 2000s, but I think you almost need another feeder league where these guys go from playing against young teenagers to playing against other players who are 18, 19, 20, and also maybe, you know, guys who are not in the NHL anymore, guys who can't get a job in the NHL. Almost, I'd say, a league like the ECHL, where you've got this list of guys who weren't good enough to make the NHL. You've got some NHL has-beens, and you've got some guys who, you know, are young prospects. But I think if we want to draft them as men to slot in immediately, we need to play them at the appropriate level to evaluate them.
Yeah, you would almost need to have like two separate leagues, like the current junior system, but have it from like, say, 16 to 18, like a hard 18, and then having a secondary league from like the 19-year-olds to, say, 22, and have it separated in that manner. But that would require a whole different set of everything, pretty much.
Well, that's it. And the fact that we've seen so many, you know, other leagues fade away, I'm not sure that there's a lot of appetite for that.
No. And that may end up just being where you would eliminate, like, how you have the three leagues, the OHL, the QMJHL, and the WHL. Maybe you keep two of those as the 16 to 18 leagues, and then change one of them to being the 19 to 22 league.
Yeah, I don't know that the NHL really has enough control over that, and I'm not sure Hockey Canada would want that. The most likely scenario to me, if you're not going to start a new league, I think the NHL would almost need to fund a new league, but it would be to work with your partners in the ECHL. Because right now, the ECHL is sort of that second-level farm team. There's never a lot of NHL guys playing that low. And even if you were to say, okay, every ECHL team can have, let's just say, four players on NHL contract reassigned down there, and the rest are all young guys or older guys coming back as the veterans. So I think it would almost be neat to see the ECHL then serve as the jumping off point to the NHL. But you'll probably end up, for most guys, going ECHL, AHL, NHL. Just based on, you know, getting drafted and needing development. That's the only way I could see such a system working.
Yeah, it would be an interesting study to see exactly how they would manipulate things in order to make that situation work. Because, like, if they just raised it to, say, 19 and didn't do anything else, what you would likely end up seeing is a bunch of players pulling an Austin Matthews and just going to Europe to play professionally in their draft year.
And then you're watching them in a very different environment. I'd rather evaluate them in North American hockey.
Mm-hmm. And that's where it would be a little more difficult and would create some problems. So I'm in favor of them raising the draft age. It's just, it's going to take a lot of manipulation to see how you could get it to work where every party is happy with that.
Yeah, and I think it's all these logistical things in the background that are going to take more time and more effort and more energy, I think, than they'd probably be worth to raise the draft age. I mean, the other thing you could do is you could try to find a deal with the AHL where every team reserves so many spots for, you know, young players to come in, so spots that aren't eligible for NHL guys. But then you're going to get this weird, well, so-and-so decide to sign with the Flames farm team. How's that fair that they get, you know, an Austin Matthews playing with them, that sort of thing?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I think to do it, I'm not necessarily opposed to it, but I think a lot of people aren't realizing the whole change in the structure of pro hockey in North America that would have to happen.
Yeah, it's not just, oh, okay, done, no big deal, carry on.
Yeah, the only other way you might be able to do it would be to have almost one or two senior teams in each of the CHL leagues, which, again, wouldn't be all that fair to some of the 16-year-olds that, okay, we're playing 19- and 20-year-olds today.
Yeah, well, those teams would just absolutely destroy everybody else.
So that wouldn't work. But I think before this could be done, and I know there's been a lot of talk of fans doing this, is there'd really have to be some thought put in there. And I don't know what the right answer is, but I just can't see any way to realistically raise that age in the current North American system.
No.
Without sending those guys off to colleges, but then you're going to lose some of them for even longer. You know, you could say, okay, you're 18, go to college and play there for 4 years. But that's not the right answer either if we're looking to move the age up solely to get guys in now. So I'm not sure what the answer is there. I don't know if there is a good answer yet or if it's just talk that's being thrown around. I haven't heard any suggestions. Have you?
No. It would be very complicated, though. I think it would end up being the good thing for the players overall. Like, especially, like, if you look at each draft, outside of the top three or four players, there's not really anybody that actually plays in the NHL that season. So, other than the exceptional players, you're not really impacting anybody. So, in terms of their development, so I don't see it being that big of a deal myself, but
no,
we'll see.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that you would need a place for those guys to play. The only other thing would be to add another minor league in somewhere, like, you know, revive the IHL or something. Have every team where you have your over 22 farm team and your under 22 farm team. And that could be a way to do it. But again, that changes the whole structure of North American hockey. And I don't know that NHL teams want to necessarily fund yet another farm team. So it's one of these things I don't think it can happen until this issue of where do these guys play is ironed out. Why don't we get back to some Flames talk, Matt, unless there's anything else in the draft you want to talk about.
That's good.
Interesting loophole that came out today that I was reading about in the hockey news is it's been found that even though he's a restricted free agent to be, Johnny Gaudreau is not eligible to receive a potential offer sheet this summer. We all think about RFAs as being guys that anyone can make an offer sheet on. And it's sort of interesting math that was figured out during insider trading with Bob McKenzie. Simply because Gaudreau has not played the necessary number of games in the NHL, he can't get an offer sheet. So even though Gaudreau will have completed his 3-year entry-level deal at the end of this season, the first year of his deal ticked off when he appeared in just one game. You might remember that in 2013-2014. Because he went from the NHL to the World Championship, not the AHL, and failed to play 10 professional games his first season, it did not count as a year of professional experience. In order to earn 1 year of experience, Gaudreau would have had to play 10 games in total between the NHL and the AHL. Gaudreau signed his entry-level deal as a 20-year-old, meaning he needs 3 years' experience to become eligible for Group 2 free agency. So this is really good news for Calgary, because, you know, not like we wouldn't have been able to match anything anyways, but should they wish to sign into a bridge deal instead of a long-term deal, this gives them the ability to do that and still retain RFA rights down the road. You know, I don't think they're going to lose him either way. I can't see somebody giving up what it would take to sign Gaudreau on an offer sheet and one that we can't match. Could you?
No. Like, they would have to pretty much max the offer sheet, max years.
But even and then,
I think you would still sign Gaudreau, because 4 first-round picks, if they're in the middle to late first round, you may get 2 NHL players out of that, and just NHL players, not good ones. So,
I think we retain his RFA rights later on is a nice accident, if you will. That okay, we could do the bridge deal if the two sides can't come to the long term deal.
Yeah, for Gaudreau's RFA status, if the Flames signed him to a 5-year deal, he would become a UFA at the end of that. So because of that, I could see the Flames signing him to a 3-year contract or an 8-year contract. So that way they could, well, if it's a shorter deal, I think they would sign him for the long term. Or if they go long term now, it's to get the contract number being cheap enough where, because if he signs an 8-year deal, it's probably going to be around $8 million. Where if he signs a 3-year deal, you could probably get him for like 6.5 to 7. But if you re-sign him after 3 years, it's probably going to be 10 or 11. So they have to weigh what's better in, over the long term.
What's the maximum term on a deal now? It's 8 years, eight, right?
8 if you're re-signing your own guy, 7 if you're signing somebody else.
Okay. So I can see that. I really think that whatever Johnny gets, they're going to have to give something similar to Monahan. I'm not sure you want to lock up both guys for 8 years.
I think Monahan would be more of a candidate for the a Barkov type contract, a 6-6 thing. Like looking around the league, the only comparable recent contract for Gaudreau would be the one that Vladimir Tarasenko signed last year, which was an 8x7.5. Monahan, in terms of production and overall abilities, the closest one was Barkov, and I think he'd get slightly more than him, but not by much.
Whatever it comes down to, I have no doubt that between money and term and the overall dollars shelled out over that term, we are going to see the Johnny Gaudreau deal be the largest deal in Flames history.
Mm-hmm, for sure. And I think that if the Flames can get them combined under $14 million for the lengthy term, that would be a win, but I'm expecting it to be 14.5 to 15 for the two players.
Yeah, I don't know. We've seen Treliving do some weird stuff so far as a GM. I mean, he's signed deals that we had no idea how they ever got them done. So it wouldn't surprise me all that much if we did somehow manage to get a good deal on these guys.
Yeah. Well, each of TJ Brody, Mark Giordano, and arguably Dougie Hamilton are paid about $1 million to $2 million less than they should be. So, who knows?
Well, that's what I mean. Like, he's got great deals on those players so far, and I see no reason why you wouldn't be able to continue that with the forwards. I think, especially if you sell these guys, that we're doing this together. You know, we all need to take a little bit of a cut to be able to win here. I think that's
because they can point to Chicago and say, look at how many players they've had to shed just to keep the 4 or 5 guys intact. If you guys all take a little bit less, we can not have that particular hangup.
And I think if you look forward and you say, okay, we now know we've got these guys for 6, 8, whatever the year is, the term is, we can then start to plan long term and say there's a good likelihood we may not be able to afford them all after this next contract. Let's sign them long. Let's, you know, get as much as we can. But then, you know, if we lose them after that, we lose them.
Mm-hmm. And at that rate, then you would be evaluating, like, say a guy like Mark Giordano, can you move him and in order to keep everybody else intact? And but that's a discussion for like 2020. So
yeah, and I don't know. I don't see them moving the captain any time in the near future.
It would be like 2020, like when Brody's contract comes up.
I think, see him retiring before the Flames move him.
Yeah, he's not that old.
No,
he's only 31.
Yeah, but he had a good season this year, but he's been fairly injury prone, and I think that's going to get worse as he gets older.
I don't see that, but myself, but
we'll see.
Yeah.
Another piece
can't
of
predict
Flames
the future, so
no. Who knows? And you know, he's been good this year. Usually we lose him for a couple months every season. So, you know, I'm just worried that he might be not as bad as say a guy like Laddie Smead, but he might be one of these guys that is never around at key times.
Possible, but won't know that until we get there.
A couple other Flames notes that we have. One is that the Flames signed one of their draft picks from The low rounds, we were talking about the low rounds and how the Flames have managed to succeed lately. Their sixth round pick in 2015, Andrew Mangiapane, has been signed by the Flames to an entry level deal. And we've talked about how he's had a great season this year in the OHL playing for the Barry Colts. Good signing, I think. You can't have too many young players, too many guys signed, and as an entry-level deal, if he doesn't pan out, we'll probably walk away. But a guy who's getting 106 points a year in Barry, you've got to give this guy a shot. And I don't see a reason why they wouldn't turn him pro next year. What about you?
Same here. And I think that you have to just wait and see how he adapts to the AHL level. If he tears that league up like he has the OHL in the last two seasons, then the Flames likely have a possible top six forward. If he struggles, then you're looking at somebody who may never actually make the NHL.
You
just don't know, though, until you get there. So
I think the nice thing for Andrew is because he's a sixth round pick, there's not a lot of pressure being put on him. You know, if there's a guy who was drafted in the top three rounds, I think there'd be a lot of pressure for him to develop. I think where we are right now, if he develops into something, it's going to be seen as a nice surprise. And if he doesn't, it's going to be, well, just another sixth-round pick that didn't make it. You know, a guy who had a good junior career but just couldn't make it at the next level. So I think for him, not having that pressure on him is going to be really helpful.
Yeah, and any time that you draft players like him, if any of them ever turn out, it's like found money. And what's the harm in that? If the guy does actually turn out, then you've maximized the value of that sixth round pick, and you've got a really good NHL player out of the deal. And if not, well, how many sixth round picks actually turn out? So it's not really a big loss if he doesn't actually work out.
If he works out, the Flames will look like geniuses for drafting such a good player in the sixth round. If he doesn't, well, there'll just be another sixth round pick that busted.
Yeah. Which, even at that rate, you can't even say it's a busted pick because it's a sixth round pick.
That's true. Yeah, I guess it's what par for the course for a sixth round pick.
Yeah, when your success rate of getting a player to play 100 games from any round from 3 to 7 is 15%, that's more the expectation than the rule.
Yeah, he's a guy I think will get 100 games. Maybe not with the Flames, but he's a guy I think, based on his junior record, if it's not here, somebody else will pick him up and say, well, we think we can get the best out of this guy. I think if he doesn't turn out to be a star, I think he might be like a Pavel Brendel, where he just jumps from team to team hoping to spark something.
Well, the encouraging thing with him is his foot speed. So, and the fact that he's able to think at the same level that his feet go at. So, between the two, that's an encouraging sign. Whether that translates or not, we will know 12 months from now.
Yeah, so. if even 12 months, I don't know that. I mean, he looked good in training camp this past year, but I'm not sure that we're really going to get a good sense of him in his first pro camp after signing a deal. I think it's going to really take a couple of years for us to see what we've got with this guy. I hope I'm wrong there. I hope he just, you know, lights it up. But I think even if he has one good camp, it doesn't necessarily mean that, you know, we're seeing the true Andrew Mangiapane. I think we're going to need, this is going to be a slow build.
Mm-hmm.
And the last news item for the week is that Sean Monahan was named the third star of the week in the NHL. So always good to see a Flame getting the three-star honors, especially in a team that is not in a playoff spot. That's good that he's really rising that occasion.
Yeah, I found it kind of lame that he got the third star of the week and not the first star of the week. Sidney Crosby got the player of the week. And he had 2 goals and 5 assists in 4 games. Monahan had 5 goals and 2 assists, and yet he's the third star. It's like, how does that work?
Yeah, I think the 3 stars is a marketing thing for the league. And Sidney Crosby is more marketable as a player, and I also think that Sidney Crosby is, and the whole way that team has played this year, you know, sort of going from really bad to not looking too bad, I think that they're really at a place where it's like, okay, you know, this is the feel-good story. We saw that earlier in the year when Johnny Gaudreau got screwed out of a first star as well.
I know. It's just that shouldn't matter.
No, I agree. But
I know. It's just annoying.
But I'm still glad to see a Flame in the top three stars, especially for a team that's out of the playoffs. Matt, you had some interesting numbers that you dug up about our offensive production this year compared to last and where we might actually be not as bad as people think. Do you want to share those with us?
Yeah, it's weird. This team last year, they finished with the eighth best offense in the entire NHL. And that was one of the reasons why the Flames made the playoffs and eventually getting to the second round. And the Flames, pretty much nothing has gone right, except for the fact that the Flames are pretty much performing offensively at the same clip relative to the other teams in the NHL. Their current pace, they're on pace to score about 15 fewer goals this year, but they're currently 10th overall in the league, only two goals back of the Pittsburgh Penguins, who are the 8th ranked team. So the offense seems to be contributing at basically the same clip. It's just that they've surrendered so many more goals against that tank the Flames from finishing in a playoff spot to being one of the very worst teams in the league.
Which really shouldn't surprise us. I mean, you know, we know that we can't say goaltending is the only issue this year, but I think we can all look at goaltending and say this is the primary problem this team has. And even management has said that this is the number one thing that they're going to have to address come the off season. So doesn't surprise me that they're scoring at the same clip. I mean, it's mostly the same roster, right? This is the same roster that we had last year.
Yeah, it's just interesting considering the Flames received 130 points from Weidman and Hudler last year, plus the 16 goals from Lance Boma and like 25 points from Josh Juris. And none of those players have played very well this year.
No, but we have guys like Frolik who've come in and are playing better.
I know.
Picking some of that up.
It's just interesting to see the fact that on one hand you have so many players struggling and yet overall the team's still doing just as well.
Yeah, and I mean, it's a combination of things, right? We're not saying that if the goaltending was changed, we'd be in the same position as last year. Yeah, a lot of the guys are struggling, and you know, we are getting more points from a fewer number of guys this year, but it tells that story that management's been telling us that, you know what, we're having issues here with goaltending, and that's the biggest thing we need to work on. And I don't think that there's anyone that would disagree that the Flames need to find more capable goaltending very quickly.
Yeah, and I did the math on that, and if all of the goaltenders that the Flames had playing for them this year, if they had produced at a .918 save percentage, which would actually put them at the 20th ranked goalies in the league, so not even average, slightly below average goaltending, the Flames would have surrendered 40 fewer goals this year. And based on the goal differential, they would be pretty much right up there with Anaheim and San Jose in the standings. So, if the Flames were getting reliable goaltending, it could very well be that this team's in the playoffs right now. But, you know, it is what it is, and
and sometimes these are the seasons you need to really wake you up, right? I mean, we've known for a while that Carriarama was not a playoff-caliber goalie. We've known that Jonas Hiller was not going to take us all the way to sip from Lord Stanley's mug. We knew this last year, and I think that really this year was probably the year we needed to say, okay, it's time to make that change, and now's that time.
Yeah, it's put a laser focus on exactly what needs to be done. And even to a lesser extent, the depth defensemen on the team and up front, moving out guys like Russell, losing Weidman and Smead to injury, it's allowed other guys to come in, and they are performing decently. So if the Flames can address some of the depth issues in the offseason, in addition to the goaltending, this team will be better overall. It's just, you gotta wait till draft day and UFA day to sort those things out.
To me, the most unfortunate part is the year we really need a goaltender, the goalie market is weak.
Well, not necessarily. With the expansion draft looming, you'll see there are plenty of teams that have two or three really dynamite goalies in their system, and they might lose some of them and for nothing. And with there only being three teams, Carolina, Toronto, and us, that need somebody to play in net, you may see a team be willing to move one of their guys just because of that fact that they'd rather get something rather than lose them for nothing next year.
That's a good point. I think that's the one saving grace the Flames might have. We don't know if that's going to happen yet, but that's the one saving grace the Flames might have is this looming expansion draft. And for those that don't know, the Flames have some expansion applications. We believe only Vegas and Quebec City. They're expected to let us know this summer if we will see an expansion, not for the coming year, but for the year after that, the 2017-2018 season. And the GMs were presented recently with two scenarios by the league for the expansion draft. Under these two scenarios, GMs could pick one of either protecting seven forwards, three defensemen, and a goaltender, or protecting eight skaters of any position and a goaltender. There's exemptions being made for first and second year pros, and they still have to figure out what to do in some cases, like no movement clauses, that sort of thing. Matt, what are your thoughts on the format of this expansion draft?
It's pretty much typical of other expansion drafts. Usually you're able to keep all of your good players unless you're one of the elite teams, and you expose mainly depth roster guys. And like when we've seen previous expansion drafts, guys like Jeff Sanderson are the best players that are taken, and you know, a solid second line guy. I think if the expansion draft comes next year, the teams that are likely going to be hit hard are teams like Washington, Florida to a lesser extent, Chicago, Dallas, St. Louis. So the Flames, on the other hand, should be more or less okay.
We asked some fans on our Facebook page who they were most worried about the Flames potentially losing in the expansion draft. We heard from one of our loyal fans, Darren Loudfoot, who said that he's worried about the Flames either losing Nakladal or Joki Paka. And those are both reasonable assumptions because we can only protect three defensemen. And you know that they're going to protect Hamilton, Brody, Giordano.
Yeah, and if I'm an expansion team and I can pick any team's 4, 5, 6 defensemen, I'm not going to be looking at a team that's in the bottom tier of the NHL. And even though Nakladal and Joki Paka are very good defensemen for the Flames,
there's going to be better options.
Yeah, I could see other teams getting hit. Like a team like Nashville would likely be far more likely to see them getting multiple players being taken, where the Flames, even if they did end up losing one of those guys, we do have the organizational depth with guys like Shillington, Anderson, Hickey to be able to replace them even if one of them was lost.
And Christian Bergvall responded to our post and said that he's most concerned about seeing the Flames lose Ferland. And in my mind, if we can get out of an expansion draft only losing Michael Ferland, I think we've had a great expansion draft.
Same here.
I think, yes, Michael Ferland's popular here, but if you look at where he sits in this team, we talked about earlier, Hathaway could replace him. Even maybe a guy like Freddie Hamilton could replace him. I think that Ferland, if he's going to be our collateral damage, see you later.
Yeah, it would suck. Don't get me wrong, but there are far worse players to lose than Ferland. for the long-term health of the team.
And the bad thing about this being at least a year away is we're going to have some of our guys in the AHL, some of our good prospects who are going to be third-year pros by that point. So, I mean, we may be exposing a guy like Emile Poirier or Hunter Shinkarik, some of those guys who depend on when exactly the draft comes down. If there's more than one draft, especially, we could be at risk of losing.
Yeah, and I think at that rate, you would possibly see them being protected over NHL veterans. And it would depend largely on what's the makeup of the team itself.
And the NHL's forcing some of that too, because I think there's a rule that you have to expose 25% of your salary cap from the year before.
Which makes sense, because you don't want to have teams keeping like all their high dollar players and here, take from our crap.
Well, you know, I'm just thinking, if I'm an owner expanding the league and I'm paying $500 million for the expansion rights, I need a good team now for that much money. So I think that this is expected with what the NHL is asking for in terms of an expansion fee. You can't say, well, it's going to take you 5 years to start making money off your team because they won't be any good until then.
Yeah. And honestly, the most high dollar player that I could see the Flames exposing would actually be Michael Frolik, even though that would hurt a lot to lose a player like
and
that.
And I think if Frolik's exposed, there'd be a good chance he'd get taken.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a good depth guy. He'd fit in well, I think, anywhere.
Yeah. It would depend largely on what's available on the market as well. Because like, the Flames are likely going to sign some players as well this offseason. So it would depend on who those players are, because it might be one of those guys instead. But won't know until we get there.
So one of the big questions, and we won't get into doing a fantasy expansion draft list or anything, because we're at least a year away from this even happening, but one of the big questions the NHL has is, what do we do with no movement clauses? Should guys with no movement clauses be exposed? Should they be automatically protected? I'll tell you my thoughts here is, if you have a no movement clause, you should be protected. You have taken generally a pay cut, assuming that you're going to stay with that NHL team. And I think that those guys on no movement clauses have to be protected. But I think that it shouldn't be over and above the regular protected number. I think if you've got a guy in a no movement clause, he automatically counts as one of your protected list. What do you think, Matt?
I think that it should be optional. If the player, say a guy has a no movement clause, but he's willing to go to Las Vegas, say that's the expansion team, it should be optional that he can say, no, I want to be exposed.
Okay.
Otherwise, it should be automatic.
Yeah, no, I'd agree with that. No. I think by default, I'd agree with that. You go on the list, you're automatically protected, and you take up a spot on the protected list. You shouldn't be exempt from the protected list. But if you've decided to be exposed, then sure, expose the guy.
Yeah, and that should be the player. They should have the first right of refusal. So if they say, no, I want to stay, then you're on the list. If you don't care, then fine. You know, there shouldn't be a restriction for you to be there.
And we always see around expansion drafts, trades happen as well. So I could see a guy who is on a no movement clause, sees the roster that's being put together and says, yeah, I'd like to play there. And then a trade's made for that player. I could see that happening too.
Well, one of the things that typically happens with expansion drafts is that the teams will actually select a high number of goaltenders.
And then flip them to other teams.
Like the Nashville Predators, they took 6 goaltenders when they came in the league. And they ended up flipping some of them to other teams for assets. So that's one of those situations that may help the Flames down the road in their search for a goaltender.
I don't think they can end up waiting another year before they wait for that, though.
Oh, I know. No, it's just for our search this off season that you know that the expansion team's likely going to take a number of goalies. So,
yeah, and I think as a current team, you would want to move one of your goalies instead of losing him for nothing. And if we look at the teams that are probably most susceptible to that, chime in if there's any you think. I think Anaheim is probably the most susceptible. They have two great young goalies in Gibson and Anderson. I could see them, especially now, maybe not as much if there wasn't the expansion draft, but if there is, trying to do a deal with a team like Calgary to move one of those guys out so that at least they're getting something for him.
Yeah, I'm already kind of penciling Anderson in as the starting goaltender for the Toronto Maple Leafs next year because of the amount of draft picks that the Leafs have and that he's not in the division anymore. I don't see him coming to Calgary, unfortunately, but...
What if we go to Pittsburgh, where they have one of the guys you've seen as the best young goalie in the league in Matthew Murray? Do you think maybe they move on from Marc-Andre Fleury and either keep him unprotected?
I think Fleury's gone.
Do you think they'd leave him unprotected to be taken for free, or do you think they try to trade him potentially to a team like Calgary and get some value out of him?
I think trade more likely than not.
And if you were the Flames GM, do you think you'd look at Fleury as a serious option here? I think he could be a good holdover for 2-3 years.
It would depend on the cost. If it was one of the draft picks, the second round draft picks that we acquired, like say the Hudler pick for Fleury, fine. Otherwise, I would be more willing to go just sign Reimer on July 1st instead.
Dallas might have a bit of an issue, though. Their goalies are both older, but you've got Lehtinen and Niemi there. I could again see them moving one of those guys out and maybe the Flames bringing one of them. They're both 32 in as sort of a short-term fix.
Yeah.
Lehtinen has no-trade clause.
Those guys both suck, though.
So. Yeah, I don't think they'd be our Stanley Cup goalie, but it might be one of those of, okay, bring this guy in and use him for 2-3 years.
Yeah, it would basically be acquiring Kari Ramo again and... You could, but why would you spend assets? You got James Reimer or any of the other guys that are on the UFA market. You just sign them instead.
The one that I think might be most interesting looking around the league is in Detroit. I think that they're looking at Peter Mrazek as their goalie of the future, and I think that Jimmy Howard is going to get moved if not before this happens. I think that he would get taken... probably one of the first picks in an expansion draft. So I can definitely see them wanting to move him out. And again, maybe not your answer long term, but I still think Howard's a serviceable goalie.
Yeah, I don't see them being able to actually trade him because of the length of what's left on his contract and that he's just okay as a starter.
Yeah.
I think he is like the number one candidate. And Mike Smith in Arizona being the number two candidate for expansion draft pickups.
If we have an expansion draft, Matt, would you expect one or two teams?
One.
Yes. Yeah,
so I think they'll do one, wait a year or two, and then a second one.
So you think that we'll see, say, I think Las Vegas is probably first just from an optics perspective. They want to go to the States first. Mm-hmm. You think Las Vegas, and then we wait a couple of years, and then we go to Quebec City?
I would... more lean that Quebec, if they receive a team, it'll be a relocation from another Eastern team like the Carolina Hurricanes, just because of the numbers in each of the conferences. Because I know that Columbus and Detroit petition hard to move to the Eastern Conference, and I don't think they want to move back. So if they do another expansion team after Las Vegas, I would assume that would be a Western team like a Seattle or a Kansas or Houston, possibly.
So you mentioned the Canes. Are the Canes in financial trouble? Are they like looking to move?
Yes and no. Apparently, there have been a lot of flights from Raleigh to Quebec City, which is atypical for them. So... some fans in Carolina are thinking that the ownership is looking at moving there. Who knows? It's possible. The team's kind of going into a rebuild again themselves, like after trading off Eric Staal, and they're kind of waffling again, and they haven't made the playoffs in a while, and they're just kind of terrible, so... that would be my likeliest candidate for a team to move.
Makes sense.
because none of the other Eastern teams are really in any dire straits. Like, Florida's winning again, so the fans are coming out. Tampa's winning again, so the fans are coming out. So, there's nobody that's terrible and in need of a relocation. Yeah. Other than Carolina.
Yeah, no, I think that makes sense. And I could see there being some pressure there, too, even from the league to, hey, you know, let's move this team if it's not doing well. I think after the Arizona thing, they're not going to want to hold on to teams that aren't doing as well anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So I think you could be right. I of the Western teams, I think Seattle becomes your most likely destination. Kansas hasn't proven they're a hockey market, even though they have a building.
Yeah. Houston might be interesting just due to the size of the city and that they would have a interstate rival with Dallas, but I don't even know if they have a hockey rink that would service even temporarily, but those are the only three that I can think of that might be possibilities.
And I think if we're looking at $250 million, I don't know that, you know, there's going to be a lot of teams that are going to be, or a lot of owners that are going to be looking to pay that. You know, and I think that really limits things too. So I guess looking at, you know, the week as a whole, some Flames news, a lot of overall news. We talked a little bit about the draft. We talked about the expansion draft. Before we leave the expansion draft, outside of goalies, how do you think this is going to affect the Flames, this expansion draft? I'm not expecting them to lose any key pieces. What do you think?
No. The Flames are lucking out in that they're kind of on their way up instead of being an elite team like a Chicago or a Dallas or whatever. They don't have the depth of talent that most teams do. So, like, you can get away with protecting most of your top six, your top three defensemen, and a goalie, and you'll be fine.
Well, even when I'm looking at their roster, like, I can't even think of seven forwards I would say I have to protect these guys.
For me, it would be pretty much Gaudreau, Monahan, Bennett, then Backlund, and if we need to protect Poirier and Shinkarik, those two, then Frolik and Colborne, I guess, and yeah. That's it.
Yeah, but that, I mean, that's it. Like, we're dipping into our AHL team there, which is good, but I think, you know, that's one of those things. I think you're going to see that with a lot of teams where the bottom six are really interchangeable parts at this point.
Yeah, like if we say we lost Lance Boma and Michael Frolik, just for sake of argument, can you replace those players? Sure. So it might hurt temporarily, but
what do you think we'd have to give up to get them to take Mason Raymond off our hands?
Oh, I think the Flames are going to likely buy him out or just keep him in Stockton for the year.
I think he'll just stay in Stockton.
Yeah. Well, the expansion draft's not until after the bad contracts with Smead, England, Weidman, and Russell or Raymond all expire, so there's not really any danger there.
And those might be the kind of guys, you know, who are looking for a second chance and might end up signing as a free agent in a place like Vegas for a lower deal, because they'll probably be looking for some capable bodies.
Yeah, that's possible, and I'm sure that a lot of UFAs after next season may look at Vegas because of the fact that the team itself is going to be kind of terrible. So,
and that might be the first time that Edmonton doesn't get the first round draft pick in recent, or the first overall draft pick in the first round recently.
Well, Vegas, if it is that, will be selecting third. So Edmonton still has a chance for number one.
They've already said that they'll be selecting third.
Yep.
Oh, wow, because usually they give them the first overall pick.
Yeah, no, it's going to be the third overall pick, so.
Interesting.
Yeah, Edmonton still has a chance to get whoever's going first next year.
Yeah, and I think part of, and again, I don't want to talk too much about the expansion draft because it's not even known that we're getting another team, but I think a lot of the draft will also depend on who the coach and GM is, and I think we might be able to predict who might go based on the type of system that we'd see that coach running.
Yeah, well, like when Minnesota was selecting, they took a lot more defensively responsible players. And you could tell based on who was in the organization.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah, I mean, if you were to get, say, a Brent Sutter who got that job, for example, you know that if he's born in Western Canada, he's probably going to go.
Yeah, and wanting to be as defensively responsible so that way the team can compete right away. And I honestly think that's what you'll likely end up seeing regardless of which team or whoever runs the team. Because if you look at the two expansion teams that have been the most successful of the four, Nashville and Minnesota, they both went heavily defensive when they were selecting. And those teams have become successful franchises, where Columbus, they went primarily offensive, and same with Atlanta, and they both fell apart. And Columbus has only made the playoffs, I think, once.
To be fair, Atlanta's not even around anymore.
No, and Atlanta relocated to Winnipeg. So I think that whichever team is going, that whatever the setup is, I think they'll go primarily defensive.
Well, Matt, let's look ahead at the week that's coming and play our predictions game. We looked last week at the week that was for the Flames. We had 8 points available. You thought that we'd probably get 4 points winning the Winnipeg and Toronto game. I thought we'd get 6. I thought we'd win everything but the Colorado game. And neither of us ended up getting it right. I was right that we wouldn't beat Colorado, but I thought we were going to beat Toronto. So the Flames end up with 5 points on the week after getting the shootout loss to the Avalanche. So we sit still with you leading us at 6-3 in the game.
Well, you've got 2 weeks left, or 3 weeks left, so... No, two.
Yeah, sort of three. 2.5.
Yeah, so you've got to start making some bang-on predictions to get back in the game.
As always, the week ahead is brought to you by our friends at TickTix. TickTix connects a sea of red to buy and sell tickets securely from their phones. TickTix lets sellers sell for free and verifies the sellers so buyers don't get ripped off. Tickets are delivered digitally, so there's no hassle in trying to meet somebody somewhere and pick them up. You can download TickTix today in the Google Play Store or the iOS App Store. And there's only 3 home games left. The Flames play Chicago this week, and then on the 5th and 8th of April, they play against LA and Vancouver. So if you want to get to the Dome, grab some tickets, go find those tickets, because if you don't go now, you're not going to get to go, and the next time you'll get to see the Flames on the golf course this summer. So Matt, let's look ahead at this week. We've got 6 points on the board, 3 games for the Flames. On Thursday night, the Flames go to Minnesota. They'll be playing against the Wild, and it's been confirmed that Nicholas Backstrom will be in net to take on his former team. Saturday night, they come back to the Saddle Dome to play the Chicago Blackhawks for an 8 p.m. start. And then Monday night, the Flames take on the Arizona Coyotes. Your prediction for the week?
I'm going to say 0 points, and I'll be the complete and total downer. As much as I think that Backstrom's going to have a good performance on Thursday, I think that Minnesota is going to be extra desperate for the 2 points because they're right in the thick of a playoff race. Chicago is Chicago, and we've struggled all year against Arizona, dropping all 4 games. So I think that we're going to walk away with 0 points. I actually think we're going to lose the next 2 after that too, but that's neither here nor there.
If you could get negative points for the week, you probably would.
Yeah.
I think the Flames are going to beat Minnesota. I think that Backstrom is going to win the game for the Flames. I don't think they're going to play a good game, but I think Backstrom is going to be able to win it for the Flames. I think that we're going to get blown out by Chicago, and I have no idea what the score is going to be in the Arizona game. Traditionally, it looks like we've been only scoring 1 point against, or 1 goal against them in most of the games this year. So I think the Flames will probably score 1, and they'll score more than that. But yeah, I think that we'll lose both the Chicago game and the game against Arizona. So my prediction's 2 points.
Well, hopefully we have a stronger performance this week than those ones, but either result, 0 or 2, but
if we would have beat the Maple Leafs, I would be a little more optimistic, but the fact we got blown out by a terrible Toronto team, I'm not all that optimistic.
Yeah, and realistically, 7 of the 9 remaining games are against teams that are top-notch, so we're more than likely going to lose a larger share of those ones, unfortunately.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. And I'm not saying that I think the Flames are going to outplay Minnesota. I think that the win is going to come solely because Backstrom stands on his head and channels his inner Mika Kiprusoff.
Yeah, I'm thinking that he's going to be extra motivated to tell his former team to stick it and, you know, try to put the knife in their playoff heart. So,
yeah, I think, I don't know. I don't think we're looking at really great Flames hockey from here on out. Like you said, we're playing a lot of...
Yeah, because like next week we go to the Honda Center and then we're playing in LA in a back-to-back. Like, those are tough under normal circumstances, but they're fighting for the top spot in the division still. So, yeah, it's going to be a challenge over at least the next 5 games.
Yeah. I'm hoping that if we only win one down the stretch, we better beat Edmonton.
Yeah, same here. And Vancouver, because, you know, to hell with them.
Win the one that matter, right?
Yeah.
Well, Matt, I'll let you go for this week, and we'll talk next week just before the away back-to-back. And I'm really hoping that win or lose, we see another good performance from Nicholas Backstrom.
Yeah, I'm hoping that he has a successful handful of games for the Flames, so that way he can try to earn a spot either with us or some other team next year.
Do you think Ordeo is going to get both Chicago and Arizona?
Probably. Well, especially the Chicago game because it's home.
Yeah.
I don't think that you'll see anybody but Ordeo in the Saddle Dome. But, yeah.
You can find us in the Dome chilling with Ordeo. That doesn't have the same ring to it as the song a couple years ago.
No, I know.
I can if they can pick up a win in Minnesota, I can see them giving Backstrom potentially another start before the Kings game. I think he'll probably start the Kings game just because the back-to-back, but I could see him potentially giving him Arizona.
Well, I think that they might try him in the Anaheim game just because of the fact that, well, hey, every other goalie has lost for the last 23 games or whatever.
That earlier.
It is.
Could be.
So, here, take it. You know,
you'll have to look
if
up,
you can beat the curse, then hey, you get a contract for next year.
You'll have to look up for next show what his stats are in the Honda Center.
Okay, I'll do that.
We'll have that research for you guys next week. Yeah, I still like the contract idea. I brought that up earlier. If you can beat the curse, you get a contract. Any goalie, if you can beat the curse, you get a contract. Whoever we put in there. It's almost like some wrestling match, you know, like a contract on a pole or something like that. If you can reach the contract, you get the contract. So, yeah.
Well, hey, got to give them some incentive.
That would be the icing on the cake. We're terrible, but at least we beat the curse. Wouldn't that be nice?
Yeah.
We'll talk more about that next week when we're back for our last show of the month of March. And we're down to single-digit Flames games, so enjoy them while they're on, because before long, we're going to be missing these.
Yeah, and then we get to ramp up for the excitement of the draft and what's going to change in the organization, how Treliving will address the needs that the team has and all that fun stuff in June and July.
Without watching Flames hockey.
Yeah. And then we'll be back for the development camp and all that fun stuff and right back at it. So
it never ends. Even when we think we're in the off season, it never ends.
No, we just get a couple weeks off to watch the Stanley Cup and then right back at it.
Well, Matt, we'll talk to you next week. Have a good one.
Thanks for listening, everybody. Take it easy and have a good one.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.